So hello everyone, we are back to you with another episode of Computer Vision Talks. Today we have with us Krishna Chaitanya. He's a PhD student at Computer Vision Lab at ETH Zurich under Professor Ender Kogulu. The major focus of his thesis is to achieve high performance for tedious medical imaging tasks such as image segmentation using deep neural networks with limited annotations while leveraging unlabeled data. So Krishna completed his bachelor's from BITS Pilani, Hyderabad, and his master's was from ETH Zurich as well. And we are going to discuss his paper that was accepted at NeurIPS. The paper is titled Contrastive Learning of Global and Local Features for Medical Image Segmentation with Limited Annotations. We are glad to host you, Krishna. Please continue.
Yeah. Thanks for the kind introduction. Yeah, so I'll present our work from NeurIPS on contrastive learning of global and local features for medical image segmentation with limited annotations. So coming to introduction, so with the advent of all these MR and CT scanning machines, the clinicians have access to study different internal organs and the anatomies non-invasively. And for many medical image analysis tasks, image segmentation plays an important role in extracting the organ of interest, which we want to analyze. This facilitates many downstream applications like diagnosis, tumor detection, volume analysis, surgery planning. But this process of annotation for clinicians is very time consuming and difficult. So it will be quite useful if we can automate this segmentation process after acquiring the image. This automation will save a lot of time and effort of clinicians to focus on higher level diagnosis and also mitigate potential human level errors. So how do we automate this segmentation task? Of course, deep neural networks. So, and this has been quite popular in the recent past, and it has shown that it can achieve state of the art results on many challenging data sets of different organs acquired in different modalities. But there is a caveat, like to achieve such high performance, we need large amount of labeled data.
Hi Krishna, I think you're not sharing the screen, I guess.
Really?
Yeah.
One second. Is it visible now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Okay, yeah. So I'll quickly recap this slide. So basically, to automate the segmentation tasks, the recent popular methods which are used are deep neural networks. So these deep neural networks are able to achieve state-of-the-art performance on many challenging data sets of different organs acquired in different modalities. But to achieve such high performance, we need hundreds of labeled examples. For example, if we train a CNN with 40 labeled volumes, and when we pass these test images, we can see very good segmentation results. But if you train the same network with, let's say, one 3D volume, you can see we get very bad results on the test images. So as we saw that these deep learning methods can yield high performance for tedious medical imaging tasks when provided with large number of annotations. And we also saw that there is a problem with this because acquiring this many number of annotations from clinical experts is expensive and time consuming. So in this work, the goal was to achieve high performance with limited annotations while leveraging unlabeled data. So in the literature, like there are multiple different directions to solve this problem. But here, with respect to this work, we divide the relevant works into three categories. The first one is data augmentation, and the second one is semi-supervised learning, and the third one is self-supervised learning. We'll see one by one how each of these contribute in the literature. So for data augmentation, we can use affine transformations like cropping, rotation, or flipping. And similarly, you can also have random transformations like random elastic deformations and random contrast and brightness, which you can add. And this will enhance the existing data set, and you will have a lot of generated images, and these you can use to train the network. And this will somehow kind of help in reducing the overfitting, which you see with limited examples. So another possible data augmentation method is called mixup, where you generate the augmented data by linearly combining labeled examples, as shown here. So let's say if the lambda was 0.7, and if we take these two images, you can see the resultant image of the cat and the bird getting mixed. And similarly, you will mix the one hot encoding of the labels and you get the resultant label, and you train the network on these labels. And this has also shown to improve the performance a lot and prevent kind of overfitting. And another possible way is to use GANs to generate synthetic image label pairs. The recent works which have shown good performance are the ones which generate these images, which are optimal with respect to the task. So here in this example I showed, like let's say if we give an image and a latent vector to the generator, let's say it generates some deformation field, and you apply this on the image to get a transformed image, let's say the deformed image here, and you pass this to the discriminator to match to the population of both labeled and unlabeled images. And additionally, you also want this to be useful to the downstream task. So you give it to the segmentation network and pass this loss to the generator so that it can generate images which are useful for the segmentation task and not generate any arbitrary synthetic images. So the second category is like semi-supervised learning, and I'll present one of the relevant one work here. So it's called self-training. So what we do here is basically we take the labeled set, we train a model with these labeled examples. In the second step, we infer the labels for unlabeled examples. We call these pseudo labels. And then in the third step, we retrain the network again with both the labeled and unlabeled images and the labels which you have acquired in the second step. And you do second step and third step iteratively until the network converges. So the third category is self-supervised learning. So here, basically the idea is that we will define some pretext task on the unlabeled images whose labels can be easily acquired. And I will show you an example in the next slide. And we train on this pretext task, the network, and we get some initialization. So the idea is that we will get some good initialization with this pre-training, so such that we can use that to fine tune to target task with limited annotations. And there are two categories within the self-supervised learning methods. One is called pretext task based, and the second one is contrastive loss. So for example, here I show two examples for pretext task based methods. The first one is rotation, where you can rotate the image with one of these four angles, and the network has to predict by what amount of angle it has been rotated. For the second task, in painting, you delete some pixels in the image, and the network has to predict the missing pixels. So with this, basically, the network kind of learns the orientation of the images or some kind of high-level information, which will be useful for the downstream task when you fine-tune this network initialization which you get after this pre-training. So the second one is contrastive learning. That's what this talk is mostly based on. So to give you an intuitive example, let's say you have an image, the query image, and you have another set of images and you want to find which image is most similar to this. So here we easily know that this is the image of the dog, which was in the other set, and the remaining images within the set is called the dissimilar images, which do not match with the query image. So basically how we find this similarity and how we define it with respect to the network, that's what we are going to see in the next slides. So, and these contrastive learning methods have yielded state-of-the-art results in many recent works. So that's also proving that we can use such kind of pre-training to get very good initialization. So the intuition here is that, okay, let's say if we take this image of the dog and there are other sets of images of different animal categories. And what we do is we create two different transformed versions of this image. For example, here we use cropping and color jitter, and we have a network and we pass these images, all these images through the network to get a latent representation. So here what we want is that the latent representation, the two green dots of the dog, should match with each other and they should be simultaneously dissimilar to the remaining images of this cat, horse, and tiger. And what we want is at the end of this optimization, all the positive pairs of these latent representations should be clustered together, and the dissimilar images should be in a different cluster. So for this, how do we define this loss for a given positive pair? So previously we have seen that X hat and X tilde are two images from the same image, but having different transformations. So here Z hat and Z tilde will be their corresponding latent representations. So here we define it with info NC loss, which has been widely used in most of the literature, explicitly in the SIMCLR paper and all the subsequent papers. So here we can see in the numerator, the positive term, and in the denominator, we have both positive and negative pair terms. So the positive set is denoted by lambda plus, and the negative set is with lambda minus. And the similarity we measure using cosine similarity, and we have a temperature scaling factor to control how what's the size of the radius of the clusters. So this loss you can define over all the positive pairs in the mini batch. So in the first iteration, you can pick a dog image and create two transformed versions of it. In the second example, you can take the cat image and so on. And you can do this for the whole batch, and that's what is denoted by this total loss. So you could apply this directly to the medical data set. So that would basically imply that you have some image and you apply two random transformations, which essentially have the same context, and you want to match them in their latent representation. So basically, essentially, you take a batch and create such examples, and all the remaining images in the mini batch would become the negative set. So we believe that this choice of positive and negative pairs can be crucial to learning good global representations. And our contribution is to incorporate domain knowledge when defining these positive and negative pairs. So in this figure, we can see that two different subjects have similar global level information, but when they are placed side by side. So, but we are not using this structural similarity in the existing contrastive learning method. So what we want to do is, we want to use this similarity which is present across two different subjects as well. So here the variability in the subjects only comes from slightly different anatomical shapes and intensity characteristics. And by this, we want to model complex similarity cues compared to the random transformations. And we devise this into two-step training process where we pre-train the encoder and decoder respectively. First, we will see how to pre-train the encoder. So how do we leverage? So with this motivation, we want to convey that how we can leverage this structural similarity which is present across roughly aligned medical volumes. So what we can do is we can partition the volumes into n number of partitions. So let's say if you partition each of this medical volume into four partitions, here I show a few examples how the images will look from each of this partition across different volumes. And then we define the positive and negative pairs accordingly. So here we can see like in the partition one, across different volumes, we have similar information, but they are slightly aligned differently in the 2D space and also have different intensity and shape characteristics, like I said before. So the first strategy which we can use is basically to select the negative images carefully. So the positive images will remain same like before, where we match the two augmented versions of an image. And we are also matching it to the original image. For the negative set, what we do is basically, we don't want images coming from partition one from other volumes because they kind of contain similar information. So we prevent this matching by carefully constructing the dissimilar set by using only the images from the remaining partitions. Let's say here, the positive image is from partition one, you pick the dissimilar images from partition two, three, and four. And so on, whenever you pick from some other partition, the positive image. So for the second strategy. So we saw that, okay, we carefully picked the negative pairs, but we can also pick different positive pairs and not just rely on the random transformations. So what we can do is we can also include the images across different volumes into this positive set. So here, this would be the corresponding images across different volumes. And with this, we can model complex similarity queues, and we can see that like from volume one, partition one image, and volume two, partition one image, you cannot make the second image from the first image irrespective of which kind of transformation you apply. So we are kind of modeling higher level similarity queues. So after this optimization, what we want is basically we want to have a cluster for each partition in the representation space. So here, since we made four partitions, we will have four clusters in the representation space. So now we have pre-trained the encoder to capture good global level representations that are useful for image level tasks like classification. We hypothesize that pixel-wise prediction tasks can benefit, like segmentation, can further benefit from learning distinctive local level representations within an image to distinguish between neighboring regions. And this can be complementary to the global representations. So we define a local loss, which is an extension of this contrastive loss, and train the decoder with this loss added on top of pre-trained encoder. So now we have gotten the encoder, we keep it frozen, and we just train the decoder with this local contrastive loss. And here as well, we have two different strategies of how to define this local loss. So in the first one, again, we apply two random transformations to an input image and we pass it through the network. We get a feature map here denoted by F tilde and F hat. So here we have picked out few local regions, and I want to show that, okay, these regions are similar because they kind of contain similar local information, but have different intensity transformations applied. And these should be dissimilar to the neighboring local regions. So, and we can construct positive and negative sets accordingly based on these feature maps. So here, instead of taking the whole image level, we are picking only the local level representations. And these local level representations will form the positive and negative pairs, which are denoted by U, V, which is the index of this local level region. And here, like the negative pairs are coming from within the same feature map, not from some other feature map. And with this optimization, again, we want to have some kind of representations clustered as shown in this figure. So for the second strategy, so what if we match images from two different volumes, but with the same partition? So this is the second strategy. So since we assume that there is a rough alignment between the volumes, so we are thinking that maybe we can match the local level features as well. So here we pass these two images from two different volumes and we get the corresponding feature maps, and we want to accordingly match the local level regions. But here we can see that they may not contain exactly similar information, but we will see this in the results, how this influences the performance. So now we define this positive set across two different images from two different volumes from the similar index U, V. And similarly, all the remaining neighboring regions, local regions, will become the negative pairs. And with the same, we again want to get a similar representation like how we have got in the previous slide. So here, again, using the previous slides for the global loss, we can again define the contrastive loss here, but instead of global level representation Z, we change it with this F of U, V, which is a feature level local representation. This is for one set of images. Similarly, you can define this for all the images in the batch. So that will be the total loss of to optimize for the network. And in this way, you can train the decoder. So after pre-training both encoder and decoder, then we can fine-tune to the segmentation task. which you actually wanted to do. And additionally, we wanted to investigate if this proposed pre-training is complementary to semi-supervised and data augmentation methods. And we evaluate this on 3 MR data sets. So the 3 different data sets which we picked are 2 cardiac data sets, ACDC and MMWHS, with different number of structures, and the prostate data set. So here we show example of how an image and their corresponding labels would look like. For the experiments, we used this pre-trained encoder decoder weights as the initialization, and then we fine-tuned it to the segmentation task using limited annotations. And we compared this with the relevant pretext task-based pre-training methods and also semi-supervised and data augmentation methods. So for the training details, so for each data set, we split it into pre-training and test set. And test set is used only at the end and not used in any part of the pre-training procedure. So in the pre-training, we use only the images to pre-train the network, and no labels are used. So after the pre-training, we go for the fine-tuning step, where we divide this pre-training set into label set and validation set. And in the label training set, we tried 3 different configurations of how many 3D volumes are used to train the network. So here we tried 1, 2, and 8 3D volumes. And validation set was always fixed to 2 3D volumes. So we run this experiment 6 times and report the mean dice score over all the structures across all the runs.
Hi, Krishna.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have a query for unlabeled images. For unlabeled images.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What does the volume mean? Each volume is a set of, is a video, right?
Yeah, is a set of 2D slices. So that can vary from from data set.
So how will you divide positive or negative? We have to do it manually.
So you divide, let's say if you pick the partition number as 4, let's say there are 12 slices in the 3D volume. So the first 3 slices will become partition 1. The next 3 slices will become partition 2.
So we are dividing into positive and negative pairs, right? For the
But that will depend on the partition. Okay, maybe I can go back to the previous slide. Yeah, so here. This is stuck a little bit. Yeah. So what I mean is that, okay, you have this volume here. So this is a 3D volume. So here you divide it into 4 partitions. Like you can see with the color coding, green, yellow, red, and blue.
Yeah.
From each partition, you can pick one 2D slice. So this loss is defined on a 2D image. So
We are applying the loss based on positive or negative.
Yes. So here, for example, in this one, so these 2 images, from volume 1, partition 1, let's say if this is the positive image, then the corresponding positive image will be the transformed image of this. And also from volume 2, partition 1, you can pick the similar image. So that will also form a positive pair.
So we have to do it manually for each?
I wouldn't say manually, but that's how you define the batch. So from the batch, you have to pick corresponding images. So you should know the indices, kind of, which indices correspond as a positive pair. Let's say if it is an array, 3D array, you should know which indices correspond to positive and negative pairs. And that you can define, basically predefine that, how you formulate that batch.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. After this training details, so we can, I will show you like with one data set the results, and then we will see across the remaining two afterwards. So let's say if we pick one specific configuration of having two labeled volumes for the fine tuning step, and here on the left hand side we have the baseline, and then we have this GR, which is the SimCLR work, where you do not use any domain knowledge in defining these positive and negative pairs, and you just rely on this random transformations. So here we have defined two different strategies. The first one is called GT minus, where you carefully picked the negative samples and did not contrast similar kind of images across volumes. And in GD, you also define better positive pairs, which are across two different volumes. And you are trying to model this higher level complex similarity cues present. So we see that both of them kind of give improvements over baseline and naively applying SimCLR. So after this, we want to understand how the local loss works. So here, let's say we fix the encoder with SimCLR one, and then we apply both the local level losses. So LR and LD are those two different local level contrasting strategies which I discussed. So in the first one, you just apply intensity transformations in the image. And in the second one, you match images, local regions, you match the local regions of images from two different volumes. So here we see that there is a drop in performance. In this, I kind of showed in the earlier image where you do not have perfect spatial alignment between the images, only the global level information is kind of same. And that kind of shows here in this result. And this might have affected the learning, and so that's why it led to subsequently lower accuracy. And we see that, okay, we can combine both the best approaches, GD and LR, and you can get further boost in performance. And this kind of trend holds across most of the data sets for most configurations. So now we can pick this best method from this pre-training, and we will compare with existing works. So let's say if we compare with the pre-text task-based methods, like which are also used for pre-training, like rotation in painting examples, which I've shown below, this works much better than those. And similarly, you can see that self-training, mix-up, and other data augmentation methods also give good performance. They are quite close to our method, especially the mix-up and data augmentation. And this holds across the other two data sets as well. So we also wanted to investigate if this pre-training is complementary to this semi-supervised and data augmentation methods. So we evaluated the self-training and mix-up here, and we combined them, both of them together. So you take this initialization, and then you can do self-training or mix-up on top of this initialization. And we see here that applying these two methods on top of this pre-trained network kind of gives further boost in performance. And here, this gray color bar is the upper bound. Yeah, this is shown for as an example, like if you have lots of training images and you train a network, this is the highest performance which you can get. And we see that using just two labeled examples, like in the blue bar for AC-DC, with our pre-training and a simple augmentation technique like mix-up, we can close the gap to within 0.1 dice to the upper bound that was trained with large number of annotations. And it's kind of similar for the other two data sets as well. So we can conclude that using domain knowledge in how you define this positive and negative pairs in this contrasting strategies can yield further boost in performance. And this local extension of contrastive loss was also found to be useful for the segmentation task. And additionally, we saw that this proposed initialization is complementary to semi-supervised and data augmentation methods. And with limited annotations, using a simple mix-up technique on top of this proposed initialization, you could close the gap with the upper bound. And you can check the more results in the paper, and the code is available on GitHub. So I would like to thank my professor and wonderful colleagues and the funding organizations. And yeah, thanks for your attention.
Started out describing the various kind of augmentations possible. It was very much from the scratch. One question I would like to ask is that, yeah, this is a very domain specific ideology. Did you happen to try it out on the generic data sets like CIFAR or MNIST?
No, I didn't try it.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think, yeah, you can also try it, but we didn't try it. We tried on cityscapes, like the local loss, like because you can train the encoder with the SIMCLR approach, but also use local loss like we defined, and we see modest improvements, not like very high improvements, but maybe we need to tweak these things. So basically the domain knowledge comes into play here, like the better you know the domain, the more tricks you can apply to make it better.
I see. So it was like you guys were working with some doctor who was helping you with the labeling, like to see how.
So the data sets which we have are from challenge data sets. So okay, we didn't really work with any of these clinicians. Yeah.
So from the audience, do you guys have any questions? We are open to questions now.
Hi, Krishna.
Hi, Nikhil. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a query that you are finding these embeddings, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you done any experiment like PCA or TSNE to see whether the clustering is happening according to what you thought?
Yeah. I did that TSNE plots, but I don't know where I have it right now. But yeah, I did do that, and I saw those clusters formed. Yeah.
Okay, that's really cool.
So yeah, any more questions? I guess not. So yeah, I guess maybe because you are explaining it with such ease and detail that the paper seems easy in reading it, might not have been so easy to understand it. But yeah, the whole idea of computing pixel-wise loss or creating a pixel-wise match was very interesting. I have read papers that were focusing not on pixel-wise segmentation, but the general idea of considering the whole image. So I guess that is it. So any informal questions on research? Or are we going ahead with any questions on the paper?
Krishna, I have a query. There are approaches from zero-shot learning, right? For the same, when you have limited data.
Yeah.
So have any comparison on that? Or?
No. Currently, no, I haven't tried any of those. Yeah, okay. I think there are few short and zero short learning methods. Actually, I was trying to work with this idea called MAML. It's like from the few short learning.
MAML. Yeah.
Yeah, last year. But somehow, I don't know, maybe something was missing. I couldn't figure out to make it work that well for my medical.
I think in
images.
MAML paper also, they have tried this on medical image segmentation. One of the experiments is there on medical segmentation.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah. But yeah, like I said, I tried it myself, but somehow I couldn't make it work to get good numbers. It was working quite close to the baseline. So, yeah.
Okay. So what is the feedback you got from reviewers and what is the point they focus more?
So basically how you define this positive and negative pairs, like using domain knowledge, I think they appreciated that. And this will change with different domains, like your set of images might require different set of tricks to incorporate that. And also like the local loss, like extending it, because most of them were already focusing on classification and did not use any kind of local loss to also learn good local level representations.
Okay.
So Krishna, I have a question. Like we were also trying in a similar domain, and the main issue we were facing was like the batch size. So SimCLR, they have like really huge batch sizes. 2048 was the batch size they use in the paper. So like, how do you manage like with medical data and these batch sizes? Because the amount of labeled data you have in medical domain is like really very limited. So any like thoughts on that direction?
Yeah, so I did not use such a huge batch size like what they used in SimCLR. So most of my training was with 40, 50 2D slices. So I feel that I tried also with higher batch size for the SimCLR work to compare. I think I could only go till 5, 12 or something because the data set also doesn't have so many images. It has like ACDC is the biggest data set and it has only like 1,000 images. So, and I did not see much difference in performance. Like if you are able to define like the positive and negative pairs, like I defined using this similarity across roughly aligned volumes concept. So with that, I didn't see the need to use very high batch sizes.
Yeah, nice.
I see. Thank you. Thank you, Ayush, for your question. I guess that is it from our side. We have had a great talk with you exploring the paper. Since I have been reading a lot of papers in medical imaging, mixed supervision, teacher, student relationship papers, learning from a stronger model, a weaker branch being supervised by a stronger model. This was easy to understand. And yes, when we are talking about medical imaging, we have to be very domain specific. So being domain specific could ease out tasks and improve performances, I guess. Thank you so much, Krishna. It was great hosting you.
Yeah, thanks for giving me the opportunity.
Hi Shambhavi, really appreciate. There was a question in the chat.
Yeah, okay, sure. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, hi. So there's a question that says, can we use contrastive learning to improve domain adaptation of the NN model? Is that to perform as well on the unseen but similar image with different resolution, scale, etc.? Good question. Shall I repeat it?
Yeah, I understood the question. Yeah, it's like for domain adaptation, right? So I think you can use it, but I think the whole point of contrastive learning is basically you're trying to kind of learn some kind of invariance, and cropping and this color augmentations are kind of providing those invariants which you want to learn or incorporate into the model. So like if resolution is one thing which you want to do, then you can, I think you have to extrinsically define those transformations. Like you have to downsample the image or do some kind of blurring, so that the network kind of sees those images in the pre-training. So then it might help in the domain adaptation, which you will get in the second data set, which can have, let's say, lower resolution or high resolution. But then again, I'm not an expert of domain adaptation, so I guess you have to check for more papers in that direction. Yeah.
I hope that answers your question. Great. Okay, thank you. I guess we would wrap it up. We look forward to great work from you in future, Krishna. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Krishna, for taking time and attending the talk.
Yeah, thanks, Nikhil, for the good questions. Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah.